Ching chong ling long ting tong. Oh! Are you freaking kidding me? In the middle of finals week.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please follow me on Twitter, friend me on Facebook. Please go to davidfeldmanshow.com to do all your Amazon shopping. We have a very special guest today. Mm-hmm. Frank Conniff is with us. You are you're an incredibly special guest.
Oh, God bless you.
And you can hear Frank Conniff on Sirius XM on the John Fugelsang show.
Every day.
On the
channel 121, Sirius XM Insight.
Insight.
Yes.
Which is not Inspire. Inspire is the magazine for Al-Qaeda, right?
We try to incorporate as much of their philosophy as we can into our broadcast.
And joining us is a man who was my muse from 2010 till about 2012, 2013. He is headlining Caroline's this weekend in New York City. You know him from Pep Talks and Puddin', which is the funniest thing on YouTube. Please welcome Mr. Eddie Pepitone.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you, everybody. It's really great to be here.
It's good to be here. It's so great to be in New York. I can't believe it. And you have a studio audience. We're here on Avenue B. Do you say where you are?
Sure.
Ah, it's great. Right across from Tompkins Square Park, where there was a revolt many years ago. Do you guys remember the Tompkins Square Park riots?
The police.
Yes.
The police. They covered their badges. Remember?
No, that, I thought it was because they didn't like the pretzel place being put there. As a rebellion.
You know, we start slow, but we build. We build, like a pretzel place joke. Who cares? It's early in the podcast. People are getting settling, and they're not expecting anything.
They're not expecting much at this point.
No, so. And they got very little.
Yes, they did. They did.
You flew in last...
It's like we haven't missed a beat.
I know. I've never had more of my jokes deconstructed than by any. That's why when we co-hosted the Fake Gallery in L.A., I couldn't do anything for my act because he'd be like, that used to get a much bigger laugh when you did that a year ago.
When did you first see Eddie Pepitone? When did you first meet him?
Oh, I don't know. I think in L.A., just at a club or something.
Yeah, it might have been The Fake, which brought a lot of us together. The Fake, which is no longer there, run by Paul Kozlowski. Yeah. You turned out to be an incredible failure.
That is incorrect.
Paul just turned out to be a failure and had to leave L.A.
Hey,
fucking disgrace, like most everybody else.
That was our sanctuary. It was an art gallery that with great art that he pretty much made, and then we would do comedy at night, and we used to do our live shows.
Eddie and I used to host the Fake show, and we did it from the back of the room with cameras facing us and then TV screens on the stage.
But what was great is that they were shitty black and white TVs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it looked like we were like a transmission from like a bunker, like and we're doing comedy.
Right.
And we always started with, welcome to the Fake Gallery, where the bicycle shop and something about gelato, the gelato-centric capital of the world, because there was a little fucking gelato shop down the block, and that was the big thing in the neighborhood.
And then you'd bring up comics.
Yeah.
And then comment on their act after.
Right, we would get to fuck with the comics
and
big
then,
time.
Do you know Adam Strauss?
Adam, I don't think so.
Very
funny
man.
You should. Thanks, Adam.
Do you know Adam?
I don't know.
He's a great comedian. He really is. In fact... is Jamie still running the improv?
Yes.
He's going to be in L.A. You should...
Oh, yeah. We'll hook you up with Jamie.
Yeah. Jamie Flan.
Flan. Yeah.
And he's lasted a long time at the improv.
He's Mr. Improv now. They've opened up a space called the Improv Lab, which is kind of a more intimate version. Mm-hmm. It's like the front of the improv, and it's really kind of cool. It's kind of a workshop environment. If you remember Meyerholt, who did great space work in East Berlin. It has that kind of flavor to it.
Like Meyerhold, who did great space work in East Berlin. Putting that, is that really?
I was just reaching, but no, Grotowski and Peter Brooks. Do you remember them?
Peter Brooks directed Shakespeare.
Well, I don't. Fuck you. I don't want to get into Shakespeare. That's pretentious. I'm just mentioning Grotowski and Meyerhold, and you have to.
We should point out that Eddie is performing tonight in Richard Foreman's Ontological Theater.
I'm used to coming into New York and just doing a bunch of Japanese no theaters and then getting the fuck out of town and just performing for patrons, mm-hmm. like one or two patrons, like rich people who have developed seeds for large corporations. And all kinds of different seeds, human seeds, like and genetically modified seeds.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a second. So we used to do live shows at the Fake Gallery with Jim Earle, who we're having on next week.
Is Jim Earle?
He's not in town, but the producer of this show, Alex Brazell.
Love Alex.
And we have a lot of fanboys here for you and Frank Conniff. It's like you're somebody who I know you guys, but these people are like in awe of you too.
Really?
Yes.
Who is? They don't know us well.
Are in awe of you.
Not every team of comedians.
And fangirls, I'm sorry.
Not every comedian could draw six people to come watch them on the podcast.
By the way, this will be about the size of the Caroline's house. So this is good practice for me. And I'm almost not kidding.
No. No.
Alex Brazell has the only bringer apartment in the world.
And boom, Conniff, there's the first strike. And it's always deadly. It's always deadly. It's what kills the shark. The first strike.
So we used to do, but the reason we're having Jim Earle on the show is because I have a very liberal podcast and radio show.
You do.
But I've known Jim Earle since 1983.
And have
Jim,
you?
Yes, and Jim knows.
My condolences.
Yeah,
on that.
And Jim knows exactly who I am and what a fraud. When I tweet out very left, knee jerk, anti Trump things,
yeah,
Jim calls.
Does
me.
Does he calls you on it?
Yeah,
he's great about calling anyone on their shit except mm-hmm. himself.
Yes.
Yeah, he gives himself a big pass.
Right. So we had in 2010, you and I, and not Frank. Mm-hmm. Frank came in on the radio show.
Right.
But we used to do a podcast that started off with sketches,
God.
And it evolved into a sitcom where you...
It was so insane.
It was insane. You were my sidekick, and Jim Earle was the band leader.
Yeah.
And we lived together in a town where everybody had podcasts. This was 2010. And all the shows...
It was ahead of its time,
it really
I think.
Was. We had Patton... Marin, everybody who's big now did the show back then.
That's right. People who will not talk to us anymore. No, literally, they will not, like, hey, Mark, like when I call Marin, or like, what? He goes like this, what? And then I don't want to talk to him.
Remember, we used to, for a while at the Fake, we co-hosted an open mic there. And you remember, Whitney Cummings used to come to that.
Really?
She did, yeah. Now I'm sure
she surprised everybody. Yes. I mean, I used to watch her do stand-up and hate it, and now I get to hate her television show.
Which one?
That are making millions of dollars.
Which one?
Any one of them.
Yeah. She once saw me at the Laugh Factory and walked up to me and said, hey, hotshot, and my knees buckled, and I thought, wow, now I get it. Like, I totally get why she's successful.
Well, she's super
confident,
right? She
called me hotshot.
Oh, flattery?
I don't know. It just made me... But anyway, we did this...
What the fuck?
What?
No. I'm a stickler for finishing thoughts.
So, Frank... So, Jim Earle was my band leader.
Uh-huh.
And we shared a bed.
Uh-huh.
But we weren't gay. It was like... It was like J. Edgar Hoover and Clyde Tolson.
Oh. Clyde Tolson?
Remember Clyde Tolson, J. Edgar Hoover?
That's a name. I thought Roy Cohn you were going to say. But
no, tell everybody.
Clyde Tolson was what Roy Cohn was to Joe McCarthy. Clive Tolson was to
right-hand man?
Hoover, like his bottom, basically.
Is right. that right?
Yeah.
Clyde Tolson. I'm going to name my next door Clyde Tolson.
He lived with, they lived together, he
right.
and J. Edgar Hoover.
They were lovers? Well, lovers is a strong word for J. Edgar Hoover.
They had nasty grudge sex. I don't know if they were lovers.
The J stood for screaming homosexual. That's what the J and J. Edgar Hoover stood for. And then you were our band leader, and you lived in the house with us, and we had all these adventures.
I was abused,
and
I
Robert
remember.
Robert Smigel fell in love with you.
Did he?
Yeah.
I love Robert Smigel. Yeah.
And the rest is,
well, that's cool.
The rest is
it was great. It was really an amazing podcast. And I think that we should erect one of those episodes and do a reading somewhere here in New York when I'm in town and Earl's in town, you know.
And you could be part of it? Because we're not going to be able to get Marin or Patton Oswalt.
No.
Or Robin.
I remember, what was his name, came and
Robin
just
Williams.
Flung the pages all over the place.
Oh, Jeff Garlin.
Was it Garlin?
Yes.
He didn't give a fuck that night.
Right.
Oh, okay. Well, he's my buddy.
He played your brother.
He would take the fucking pages and go, there's another fucking piece of shit page.
Right. He played your brother.
Yeah.
He had just gotten
back. You remember all this?
He'd just gotten back from a USO show.
How do you remember this?
And we had Carlos Alzeraqui play Maury Amsterdam, and the two of them were heroin dealers. That was.
Oh my God.
Do you remember that?
And,
no.
Anyway,
so was
I remember Garlin and Carlos being there, but I don't remember the plots.
Was Garlin disdainful of the script because it didn't live up to the high standards of Daddy Daycare?
Or the Goldbergs?
Now, I have to play my cards very carefully here because I may be in a Garlin thing coming up. So I just want to say this to the people who are listening. Just go fuck yourselves. I'm just on a podcast with David and Frank having fun.
Right.
No, really. These people, if they take it personally, fuck them.
Right. No.
You know?
And we love Jeff Garlin.
I do.
So you've been very busy besides playing the clubs and becoming, and Frank, talk about how great a stand-up comic Eddie Pepitone.
Don't
seriously.
Put him on. The look on his face was like, really?
No, in private, we've talked about how much we resent
him.
He's
one of the funniest. There's no doubt about it.
Right.
He's one of the few guys, because I'm so narcissistic and only think about myself, but he's one of the few guys I would actually go to see him in a club without me having to be in the show and have my moment of everybody pay attention to me. I'm
willing
to throw that aside to watch Eddie Pepitone.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
I remember one of my sons was in college, and you were in town.
One of your sons?
Yes.
I thought you only had one.
Well, we don't.
Go ahead.
Yeah. And we went to see you. And
Willie, yeah.
Yeah, we don't talk about him on the podcast. Do you remember? Anyway, and I got a whole lecture back on the ride home.
From Willie?
Don't mention him by name.
Oh, right, okay. From Child X.
By just how much of a better comic you are than I am. To the point where it got to, I thought, was Eddie that good, or is there an issue between us, son?
I think it's a lack of love he received from you.
The other thing, and then I'll stop talking about the sitcom, but the one thing you used to do is Rosenfield.
Who cares?
Yes. He would, we write the script. He did the heavy lifting.
Oh, yeah. He was, he great
He really
writer.
Did the heavy lifting.
Does he write for Door now?
I don't know what he's doing. We're not talking anymore. He's mad at me.
He doesn't write for Door anymore?
No, he doesn't.
Okay. We should probably talk about this off the air.
So,
but go ahead. So,
we would hand you.
Is he mad at you now?
Yeah, he's mad at me. He would. People get mad at me for some reason. Mm-hmm. People don't.
That's why I'm laughing.
For some reason, people have a problem with being used, exploited, taken advantage of, and taken for granted.
You mean that's it? 3 years of the podcast and nothing else?
Nothing.
Nothing.
That was fun. So we would hand you a 50-page script.
Yeah.
And I'd introduce you, and you would cold read these you are the greatest cold reader. You really are.
Yeah. But that's also why I think I don't remember the podcasts. I mean, the plots, because I would just be so intent on getting the lines right that I couldn't take in the whole picture. So. Yeah, but
the
I did cold
thing
read
we,
him.
One of the first, I'll stop talking about the sitcom, but one of the first things we did with Margaret Cho.
By the way, I wasn't on that sitcom.
I know.
I wasn't there for that pilot season.
Yes. but one
Love
episode
pilots.
We did was we all went, we took Margaret Cho to Iraq. For some reason, you wanted a hammer from one of Uday and Kusei's rape rooms. And Margaret was going to get it for you. And you literally turned to me. It was like one of our first episodes. And there's a pretty packed audience. You whispered, so what happens next? Like everybody else do the script fight. And you were just doing this amazing cold read. How's your acting career? I would assume you're just doing really well in Hollywood right now.
You would assume wrong.
I would assume everybody wants to be in business with you.
Really? That's what my manager says, too. But it's hard. It's hard. I recently auditioned for a Cameron Crowe thing. He's got something on Showtime.
Oh, he's got a new series. Yeah.
Roadies,
yeah.
And I was supposed to... Like, what happens with me in auditions is I so many of the time, I am not inspired by the fucking material. Like, it's just kind of like, really? Like, it was a scene where, you remember the Philip Seymour Hoffman role?
Lester Bangs, famous.
And so it was a rock critic who had to speak into his tape recorder saying, "This band doesn't know that they're dinosaurs," and I was so uninterested in it, that I kind of fucked up the audition, you know. Mm-hmm. But anyway, but I'm getting some work, mostly voiceover stuff, like on cartoons.
Oh, really?
I still call them cartoons. I don't call them animated features.
Are there any you'd like to rub my face in?
I'd like to rub your face in a lot of them, you know. Bob's Burgers, maybe you heard of that.
Yes.
Fuck.
There's some jokes that maybe we'll omit. Some jokes we used to
do them.
No, what, there were a couple of...
Worked on that for a while, huh?
There were a couple of Eugene Merman. And
Oh, yeah. I like taking shots at him, too.
We didn't even know who Eugene Merman was.
He's in the area, though. We got to be careful.
Yeah, I know. We used to go after Mike Birbiglia. We had no idea who these guys were.
And now they're... Like, Birbiglia in particular is big.
I did a show with him not long ago, UCB. Very nice guy.
He is a sweet guy.
He's a sweetheart.
You know, but we don't like him because he's very successful.
Well,
and I think that's a good basis to, you know, really not like somebody.
One of the things we did is we asked our listeners to write in questions.
I like this. I usually don't do this.
And it was not to leave you out, Frank, but participate. But they're questions for Eddie because not that I take you for granted. But we don't get Eddie... In New York, that often.
Right. Okay.
So we have some questions.
So it's okay if I answer some of them, too?
Yes. but as Eddie.
I can't do Eddie.
No, you... but this is a question, and then you can respond, because you may not agree with Eddie on some... I know
we've come to a loggerhead several times.
Okay, Jennifer Bronstein writes in.
Jennifer Bronstein.
Yeah, you were recently at a Trump rally in Muscatine, Michigan. A man in a turban was heckling Donald Trump. Reports surfaced that you were there and sucker punched an Asian woman. Why?
Well, look. First of all, I love the art of sucker punching. It's the great... It is the punch of the coward. And I'm a big coward. And I said to myself, who could I hurt and probably not get hurt in return, at least immediately? Because sometimes you sucker punch someone and, you know, it doesn't really hurt them and then they kill you. But if you hit someone... you know, smaller and petite, you know, you have a good chance of surviving. And that was all that was involved.
But
I've taken a lot of heat from it. And, you know, she's recovered nicely.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see what the big
deal
is.
That's one of the best and most reasonable explanations of sucker punching I've ever heard.
Yes.
The punch of the coward.
Yes.
Yeah, like they don't see it coming, and then if you watch people sucker punch, like they have surfaced now, like that horrible video that I saw of that guy sucker punching a guy at the Trump rally coming up the steps. I watched that last night, which is awful. Like I shouldn't watch shit like that at 3 a.m. because I'm trying to get to sleep. I'm trying to unwind from shows, and then I watch these videos, and I just think, oh my God, this violence is so terrible. It's really scary. Like, it's really scary to me. And everybody watches these stupid
Did you see the clip today of Trump when the Secret Service men came up on stage?
Well, he thought he heard. Was there a loud? He's because hearing loud noises.
There was a for a moment. There was a look on Trump's face of sheer terror.
Yeah.
And that at that moment, I think maybe he might drop out of the race because if it starts to get scary to him, like he, you know, he would leave in a second.
Well, what happened?
It wasn't. I think someone jumped over a fence, you know, that was surrounding a bicycle fence, mm-hmm. and threw something at the stage. And
someone threw something at the stage?
Yeah, and that's happened to all of us. But
tonight I got a couple of shows.
And the Secret Service got up and surrounded him. And
yeah.
But before they came up, I saw it on a
yeah.
someone posted it. There's just a like he like looks like he's about to hit the ground for a minute. Like he's real. You can tell Trump is really, really scared.
And yeah.
In other words, it's a really beautiful thing to watch.
Now, but why are you at Trump rallies and why are you supporting him, Eddie? Because your politics.
Well, first of all, he's got beautiful hands.
Mm-hmm.
Why am I at Trump rallies? Because look, he's the only candidate who talks like someone from Staten Island,
mm-hmm.
which is where I'm from.
Right.
Like, oh, really? Really? So they cut our heads off and we have to give a shit about waterboarding. Where else are you going to get that?
Uh-huh.
You know, are you going to get it from Kasich? Are you going to go to a Kasich rally? That's like going and just watching the contents of a briefcase.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? Like
sure.
Trump is comfortable in his own orange skin, as opposed to
that spray tan?
It's a spray tan. Yes.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That's awful looking. That shit.
I think it looks great. And you've been writing for him, right? And
yes,
you've met him. And you're friends with Melania.
With Melania?
Didn't you?
Is that the name of his...
His the new first lady.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't keep up on his personal... I know that, you know, there's all these pretty women who surround him,
mm-hmm.
and I just love that, you know, because to me, if you're going to run for office, you've got to be surrounded by hot broads. And I mean broads, you know, I'm using ship terminology. Like, you know, there's shit. I used to take the ferry, and so this is how we talk. We're like, hey, let's get a hot dog from that broad over there. You don't say woman on a ship.
Right.
Especially the ferry.
You're from Staten Island.
I don't want to brag.
And this we have a
I'm from Brooklyn and we moved to Staten Island. I like to say that because Brooklyn still carries some kind of credibility, street credibility. Whereas when you move to Staten Island, you kind of lose all street credibility.
Why?
There's nothing there. There's nothing there but hatred. People waxing their cars. You know, people waxing their cars. Nobody knows who Dostoevsky is.
Because he lives in Brooklyn.
He lives in Greenpoint.
Yes.
So this is a question that comes to us from one of our listeners,
mm-hmm.
Maureen Greenberg.
These are great names you're coming up with.
Yes. Eddie Pepitone, you are from Staten Island, and you used to sand floors. Is it true that you would break into people's homes in Staten Island and sand their floors against their will? What would compel a man to do something like that?
Well, I love to make... I love power. I love power, and, you know, what I also love, and it's very similar to the sucker punch, is the element of surprise. Because when you break into someone's home, they usually think either A, he's going to sexually assault me. And to me, that's very predictable. And two, he's going to rob me. No, how about I break into your home and I sand your fucking floors at no charge? Because that is the thing, you know, this person did not mention it, but I did a fucking damn good job. Like, I didn't just do one of these, oh, I'm a crazy, power-hungry, you know, floor sander. I'm going to do nice touch-ups. I'm gonna make it better than when I left it, and you're going to fucking watch me, you know?
So you would get arrested by the police.
Yeah.
And
I was put in a chokehold many times, which is why I don't know why they're complaining about these chokeholds.
Yeah, he would get arrested, and yet he'd get great reviews on Yelp.
That's right. I managed to
I managed to combine incarceration with 5 stars on Yelp.
Now, how were you in prison?
How was I in prison?
Yeah. Were you funny?
I was extremely nervous. Did you ever see Shawshank?
Yeah.
Do you remember the guy who worked in the library who couldn't take the real...
James Whitmore.
But what was his name? He had some kind of cool nickname. Anyway, we'll think about that in the five years. That'll come to us. But I'm that guy. I was that guy in prison. Like, would you like a book, sir? This one's on the origin of birds.
Right.
And he'd be like, you come here and you suck this. And I'd be like, so that's a no on the book?
Do you remember we tried to break Eddie out? It was like the Shawshank. He had to crawl through 3 miles of shit.
Thank you for that, by the way, guys.
But then you crawled back into the prison. You just wanted to crawl through the shit.
Well, once you're in the joint, and that's, or the big house.
Uh-huh.
What?
The slammer?
The slammer, whatever, you know, the kids are calling it today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't want to go out to the real world because I got used to my 3 squares, the sex in the laundry room.
And why your Cameron Crowe audition didn't go well, because he's just not adjusting to the outside.
I have no idea what to do. I was like, who's going to sexually assault me in this audition? Mm-hmm. It's not going to be Gail Levin, who was the auditioner.
Gail Levin.
You don't have to highlight that. She's a big shit in Hollywood, you know? So I don't know why you would have to highlight.
And you tried to crawl through her to get that job.
She don't come here, you little fuck.
Do you remember how we alienated all... On the radio show, we used to do... Anytime we would read in Variety that some piece of shit at NBC or ABC got elevated... From like assistant programming to head of creative arts, we would do late breaking news and Paul Dooley. We would treat it as the most important news story in the world. I have to find those.
But it would always be nasty too. Like they kissed ass, or you know, they have a position that is just so boring, or it was just scathing, which I loved because.
And then what it did is it allowed us to come up with a reason we weren't doing well in Hollywood. We were pissing off people on a show that nobody listened to.
You know, this is, by the way, this is great. People tuning in are listening to a podcast where people are talking how great another podcast was.
Yeah, you're right. By the way, I auditioned for Cameron Crowe for the role of Penny Lane.
Penny Lane?
Yeah. And I didn't get it. It went Goldie Hawn's daughter. Guy.
Ah, I auditioned for his movie Not Even Fucking Close to Famous.
And they went with someone else who was equally as obscure. I'm sorry, Mr. Conniff, you do fit the bill, but still, we'd like to keep you in that mode.
Are there any parts that you can brag about? Anything coming up that we should know about?
I'm a regular in an Adult Swim show called Your Pretty Face.
Oh, with Craig Rowan.
Yeah, and I just filmed the second season of an episode of the second season of Love, a Netflix thing with Paul Rust. I filmed it on Wednesday before I came to New York.
That show, I haven't seen it, but Dave Gruber Allen is in that show.
And, oh, Dave! Yeah, I worked with him last year.
And Steve Banos. Two friends of mine.
So. Yeah, yeah.
Because otherwise, I saw the previews of that, and I'm like, oh, yeah, this is about people I have no interest in whatsoever. But now that I know that great people like you are in it.
I do that with every show. Like,
yeah.
I just turn on the TV, and I see a couch, and I'm like, fuck this show. Who fucking has a couch? I'm just so cynical and angry at everything.
Like, how is your anger?
It's okay. You know what I've learned as I've gotten older? You can't really be angry all the time because it kind of eats you alive, you know? Like, there's so much to be angry about, but you have to find a way to, you just have to find a way to sublimate it, you know, to not be that fucking angry.
What do you do?
Ah, God. I don't know. I try to get perspective on it.
you know? Yeah. And what happens, really what happens is that my anger, like feeling it all the time, I just realize, holy shit, like I just, like when you're angry, it just, you feel this momentum of like, oh my God, I'm going to be angry at every, I'm going to have a fucking heart attack, basically. So I basically like kind of just pull back and go, oh, there's a hummingbird. Like you try to notice like just little things instead of thinking about, you know, the shit.
Mm-hmm. Staying in the moment.
Yeah, gratitude. Like, just gratitude, being like, oh, humility. trying to be grateful, you know, for little things. It's hard, though.
Yeah, it is. If you can live in a state of gratitude, you'll be much happier. But it takes work to live in this in a state of gratitude. You have to work, because the opposite is what comes.
And what's curious about the license plate in the state of gratitude just says, fuck you.
And you were in prison.
Hey, how come I didn't say that?
I don't know. That was your type of joke. But I was trying to get you out of that. You know, you were just spouting a platitude right then about gratitude. Oh, you got to live in gratitude. And I was like, save it. Save it with the license plate joke. And I learned that in prison. Because we made a lot of license plates. Uh-huh. And there was an opportunity for me to use it.
Platitude, yeah.
Do you meditate?
You know what? I tell people I want to impress I do. but I don't really, I don't do it enough.
It's hard because your mantra is, fuck everybody.
I learned a mantra. I was taught by Laura House, who's like the guru to comedians in L.A. Mm-hmm. I learned transcendental meditation. I got my mantra, mm-hmm. which was not fuck you. It's this beautiful little word that I got really sick of, mm-hmm. you know, because you repeat it over and over in your head. And I would try to.
What was the word?
You're not supposed to say it publicly.
My mantra was, I paid too much for these shoes.
That didn't nothing. Help. I love how that got nothing. my mantra. It was just. It's just a word that goes, like it's a word like that.
I have a mantra like that.
Sham,
as well.
It was.
What's your mantra?
Well, if he's not going to say his out loud, Sham. I'm not going to say mine.
No, I did. Sham. Yeah. They tell you not to say it out loud because they make you pay for this
right.
word. You know? Well, you have to pay for words, you know.
My mantra is ah-ing.
Ah-ing?
Ah, that's why you're fucked up. That's not a cool...
Those are two words.
Yeah, well, you got fucked.
Yeah. Maybe he got two for one. Maybe
he got two for one.
Did you really try meditation?
I took a class in TM in
At Trump
70s,
University, right?
All the way...
At Trump University.
Trump University, yeah. And they put me under a spell, and then I gave it a great rating when I filled out the form.
Do you meditate?
we don't need to know how miserable I am. Hey, Eddie, this comes from...
I'll take that for a no.
This comes from Clifford Andreozzi. He writes...
Ooh, Clifford.
Clifford. You know Clifford?
Mm-mm.
Oh, okay.
Mm-mm. He's like the Mrs. Miller of this show.
Mrs. Miller. Tell everybody who Mrs. Miller is.
Okay, as long as we don't go on a tangent. But Mrs. Miller was a woman who was always in the audience of the Merv Griffin Show, The Tonight Show.
Carol Burnett, I think.
Any show in New York.
In New York.
Was, and like on the Merv Griffin Show, like she became a running joke because she was always this like very kind of stoic older woman. And then... So she became kind of famous in a novelty kind of way, and she actually put out an album of mm-hmm. Mrs. Miller sings folk tunes.
Right.
Yeah.
Did
right.
she really?
And then she moved to the South.
Oh, I didn't know that.
She moved like to Nashville and put on shows and...
She all that. Did?
Yeah.
So she was an opportunist. Like she comes across as this little old lady who used to sit in the audience and people loved her because she was just like, oh, I'm just at this show. But as soon as she got some fame, she was like, fuck it. I'm putting out an album. I'm going to the South. I'm gonna do the whatever that circuit is down there.
And tell us who Monty Rock III was. I'm kidding.
He was another guy. He was on a lot of talk shows. In
you being serious?
You know Monty Rock III? He actually had a song, like disco something. He was a hairdresser, right?
He was a hairdresser. Oh, he was like just like a character, you know, basically, that they had on.
You don't know who Monty Rock III is?
Uh-uh. Okay. Thank God, because that separates me from you two.
Clifford Andreozzi writes,
you have
Eddie,
to start the show over because we've lost everybody.
St. Patrick's Day is around the corner.
Mm.
Eddie, you are part Sicilian and part Jewish.
That's right.
And you claim that you want a parade for people who are specifically of that mix.
That's right.
But Sicilian and Jewish, isn't that what a Puerto Rican is? And don't you already have your own parade? Is that true that Puerto Ricans are part Jewish and part Sicilian? Is that what a Puerto Rican is?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. If you talk to any Puerto Rican,
yes,
they will tell you that their ancestors are from Sicily and, in the case of my mother, Russia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so most are Russian Jews, Sicilians, Puerto Ricans, and nobody knows that. They slap a label on it, boom, they're done.
Right. So why do you, why do you Puerto Ricans speak Spanish?
Look, I don't have the answers to everything. They're hard workers. They wanted to distance themselves from their heritage. You know how people get ashamed of their heritage? Like, I get a little ashamed of being from Staten Island because I know, you know, a lot of it is very brutish. It's like the Hobbes saying, Staten Island, life is short and brutish.
But what I don't understand is you go out of your way to identify yourself as part Sicilian and part Jewish, but not Puerto Rican. Wouldn't it be simpler?
Right.
Are you a self-hating Puerto Rican?
Yes, I think I am. You know what I find interesting about these questions? That they're really a vehicle for you. For your for your fucking jokes that I have to make work, which I'm really not into right now. And I know if Conniff isn't chiming in. Fuck you.
I don't want to touch the Puerto Rican thing with a 10-foot pole.
You what?
I didn't want to touch the whole Puerto Rican thing.
Why?
I actually didn't want to either.
Oh, okay. All right.
Mm. Okay. Who am I, Jim Norton? You know, oh, black people, white people. I never do that.
Why not?
That shit in my... I don't know. Because I don't think I know enough about white people. See that little twist? That was a Conniffian nice. Twist. Have you?
Is ethnic humor dangerous to you?
I think it is.
But people would say, Eddie or Frank, all comedy, like there are no rules. You should be able to talk. There's a First
I think
Amendment.
That's total bullshit. I think that's total bullshit. I think there are plenty of rules.
People say it's the First Amendment. You should be allowed to say whatever you want.
No, that's ridiculous.
You can be allowed. It's whether what is your judgment and whether you say something or not. You know, and there's such a thing as having good judgment and poor judgment. My career has been a litany of poor judgment.
Whenever it starts with my career, I know I'm going down that beautiful, beautiful path with Frank.
But you're beloved, Frank.
You are beloved.
Mm-hmm. Because I'm Puerto Rican.
Yeah, but I think that, you know, dealing with race issues, especially in the age of, like, the Twitter age, and, you know, there's so many fucking thought police. I kind of don't trust where I would go if I really, like, opened up. No, if I opened up my subconscious.
Your inner Staten Island.
If I opened up my inner Staten Island, where... Where the fuck would that go? I try to open it up in regards to my own personal Michigas, which is a Puerto Rican word. What the fuck with the Michigas? What the fuck with the See, already,
yeah.
I'm trace being on territory.
Within the last minute, someone wrote an outraged article on Salon.
I hate all those.
Yeah.
Precious little.
Well, we tried to. Our mistake was we tried to make it in the comedy world at the time when comedy isn't as popular with some people as comedy umbrage. Which is hugely popular these days on places like Salon.com.
Or else. Explain that.
Yeah, explain
well,
that.
Just a fly, well, here's Salon is a good is an example that we have a personal connection to because you and I and Judy Gold and Meryl Marcoux and Harriet Mantel several years ago were hired at a very meager fee, but a fee nonetheless, to provide videos for Salon.com.
Oh, really?
Comedy videos, little one-minute whatever we thought was funny. And we did that for like a couple of months, if that.
Mm-hmm. One and minute they, videos? Like, well, yeah, oh, here's just, an umbrella
talking,
and cheese.
Talking into the computer, oh. You know. Yeah. And but then Salon said, you know what? We don't want to be about, we don't want to have comedy on this site. We want to have comedy umbrage on this site.
Is that-
and so then Salon literally became famous as the place where people wrote outraged articles about what Patton Oswalt said or about some, him so-and-so doing a rape joke or, you know, and that's, yeah. That ended up getting them more clicks as far as they were concerned than actual comedy.
Mm-hmm. And do people have a right to be offended by, say, Daniel Tosh?
Yeah, everybody has a right to have whatever your opinion is. And Daniel Tosh has the right to do whatever joke he wants, but you just have to accept whatever the consequences is of what you say. And if people object to it, then that's fine for them, you know.
But
don't say that nobody... everyone should stop being uptight, and because I'm offended by things, you know, and I say things that offend people, it's just the way it goes.
Is Trump a backlash to everybody being overly sensitive? Because I think Reagan was.
No, that's a complete bullshit, and him and other people in me have tried to put that forward, that our society has become so politically correct that Trump is a backlash to that. No, Trump is a racist who appeals to racists, and that's why he's popular.
One thing I want to add about Trump that that liberals like yourself don't talk about, and I am being serious, is that he appeals to the powerless, disenfranchised working class that has been fucked to the extreme by fucking liberals, and by liberals. I really mean this. By liberals, I mean Democrats who fucking sign NAFTA. Mm-hmm. And all these fucking jobs. No, let me finish. All these fucking jobs, these blue-collar jobs that have gone overseas and are not coming back, there's pissed off fucking white people.
Right.
Because they don't fucking have jobs. And they're gravitating toward this racist shithead.
But why are
because
not,
they're
I have
fucking
I have
angry?
I have a question.
If you're not, if you have an outlet for that anger in Bernie Sanders,
yeah,
so those,
I agree.
People like that who are not
that's
who don't
true.
Like racial demagoguery are going to Bernie Sanders. The people who have whatever those legitimate concerns are, but still they can hear what Donald Trump is saying and I agree
they tend to be not college educated, they're just fucking primally going to Trump instead of Sanders. Yeah, the correct choice is Sanders for that rage. I think that's obvious, but that is true, and that's scary to me, that hate. But I think that's what's not talked about with Trump is why aren't the liberals talking about all the people, the working class, lower middle class people, middle class, that they have fucked?
Well, Sanders is talking about that, right?
Yeah, I think, yeah, he is,
but
right?
He's running as a Democrat. He was an independent.
Huh?
So, this is Sanders' first time running as a Democrat in a long time. He was a...
Well, yeah, he's been a socialist or an independent his whole career.
Who do you hate more, Eddie? I'm being serious. Me or Frank? No. Who do you hate more?
That's a very hard call.
Who do you hate more?
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, you're a progressive liberal, probably a socialist.
Socialist.
You're a socialist. Who do you hate more?
Yeah,
liberals or conservatives? On a visceral level.
Well,
if you had a cold cock somebody,
if I had a sucker punch somebody,
please keep in mind when you answer that I'm sitting right here.
I tried to sucker punch you when you were on your way to the bathroom and just hit the wall. That's the problem with sucker punching is when you miss, you really can hurt your...
You sucker punched me many times when we were co-hosting the Fake Show.
That's true. Seriously. I don't know. I think they're equally vile.
But if you had one punch to throw, who would it be at?
I guess the conservatives, because
really?
I always have just despised the right. And I, you know, I mean, it started with Reagan.
Don't you hate ineffectual people who are on your side more?
Well, what I hate is people, and this is what's really hateful about
quote unquote liberals. And by the way, all these terms are such bullshit to me. Liberals, conservatives, it's all bullshit. But people who were like, let's use Alec Baldwin as an example. I don't know if he's a friend of the show. But Alec Baldwin is what I like to call like a limousine liberal. Mm-hmm. Or the all these fucking liberals who like, and Clooney has come into my fucking radar lately because I find out he's been shilling for Nestle.
Wow.
Well, you know this. But
I didn't know that.
He's doing these commercials for Nespresso with Danny fucking DeVito.
Right.
And these are big liberals. Now you can't have it both ways. You can't have it both ways.
First of all, I like George Clooney.
I used to.
I think maybe he made a deal with Nestle that they would no longer be selling the powdered breast milk.
No, he did not.
I guarantee you that he made some kind of deal for Nestle.
Google it. I did. I thought so too.
There is no way George Clooney would endorse Nestle because he's devoted his life to the Sudan. There's no way he didn't work out some kind of deal where Alan.
What has he done in the Sudan? Good stuff?
He drew attention to there. He goes there. He testifies at the UN and Congress about the plight of.
Can I just say something for any really old people that are listening right now?
Old people?
Nestle makes the very best sellouts.
Well, they dried up all the African breasts. They got African women addicted to Nestle's powdered breast milk, and then
I don't understand how he can do both. And that's what those kind of liberals.
I guarantee you.
All right. Your listeners.
There's no way.
Write in because I Googled it and he got pissed at people who called him a sellout. He said, hey, I want to earn a living once in a while.
He said that?
Yeah.
Did he really say that?
Yes.
Because that is fucked up.
Yes.
Because he makes a good living, I think.
He fucking said, I can't stand these people who call me out being a sellout. I fucking Googled it. And I'm not bragging that I have that kind of technology, but I Googled it, and he was like, I'm fucking, it's insulting. I'm trying to make, a living once in a while. And he was quoted as saying, because he didn't blow up the budget on a couple of films he did, like The Descendants, and like he can do better projects if he makes a shitload of money commercials.
But he did something really good for the universe. He headbutted David O. Russell.
He really did. Yeah. He's done some good things.
So did you know that he headbutted?
I do know that, and I've never met either of them, so it means nothing to me that he headbutted him.
Let's talk about.
Yeah.
Now you claim that these questions are really setups for me to be funny, and I really am offended by that.
Well, it got a big response from our studio.
I know, but you know what? I can only,
which is probably
these are
a signal of truth. That's I look to the audience as truth signals.
Okay, but these are legitimate questions that have been asked on the internet. And in no way are setups for me to come across as funny. I promise you that, okay?
That was very convincing.
You say it beautifully, like a pathological liar.
Alexander Fields has this question for Eddie.
Ah, that's not a made-up name.
Alexander Fields writes, Eddie, you're a Yankees fan.
I am.
What?
Why does that crack you up?
What were the odds that Lou Gehrig, who played for the American League with the initials AL, would be diagnosed with ALS? How do you explain the phenomenon of Lou Gehrig, who played for the AL, the American League, would be
This is definitely not just a joke you're writing.
No, that's just a question.
This is a question from some guy who lives in Hoboken.
Who has a question. I mean, what isn't it ironic?
Those are tremendous odds, and this is a great question.
And plus, Lou, a lot of people don't know that Lou Gehrig had a secretary named Cancer. And Cancer had a secretary named Gehrig. So.
Yeah, the tie-ins to disease were written all over Gehrig's personal life, but there are a couple of new diseases. Hopefully, there'll be a Derek Jeter disease and a Paul O'Neill. Hopefully, there'll be more diseases coming from the Yankees.
Well, this is an actual question. How do you reconcile the fact Eddie Pepitone?
Yeah.
You're a Yankees fan, correct?
That is correct.
They are.
I feel like I'm in front of the McCarthy hearings. That is correct. I know I say I'm a socialist, but I root for a corporate entity that, like the Yankees.
Question. And by the way, Eddie would have done that Nestle's commercial in a second.
That's what all my friends say. They're like, offer you that money, you do it.
That's
and I'd be like,
no,
fuck
but that's
you.
A different issue.
You're right, but you're, still, you're fuck a, you.
You're a working actor who depends on a national commercial to make a living. Someone like George.
The
Clooney,
celebrities doing it really suck. Yeah.
Would you do a commercial?
Hey, Alex Baldwin for Capital One. He spouts all this liberal shit. How about all these people who do the Capital One shit? Like, to me, Samuel Jackson shilling for Capital One. He's been in the biggest grossing movies of all time. Like, his box office supposedly is a record. Now, I get excited when I get a residual for Bob's Burgers. I can't imagine what his fucking residuals are monthly or quarterly, whatever the fuck it is.
You know who can? All his ex-wives.
Is that true? But it's crazy. These guys, I don't know. Just
who?
Fuck them.
Clooney doesn't have any ex-wives.
No, I'm talking about Samuel L.
Jackson. Didn't he just get divorced?
No, he just got married. I'm talking about Samuel L. Jackson's ex-wives.
Does he have ex-wives?
I would assume.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I love this gossip. I love celebrity
gossip.
But
you know what, though? It kind of raises a political issue in a way of the fact that all of the, you know, it used to be that voiceover work, commercials were a way for there to be a middle class in show business for actors to survive and get by and pay their rent.
But
now this in this day and age, like, gigantic movie star, like, and big stars like John Hamm and George Clooney, they do voiceovers.
Does Hamm do voiceovers too?
Oh yeah. John Hamm does a ton of voiceovers.
He's a nice guy.
And it's then people being a movie star, if you had an Oscar in the past, you would never do a commercial. You would never do a game show. Like, something like that would be like for a middle class person
beneath you in show
business would do Hollywood. Alec Baldwin is a good example, because that was kind of, for me, I don't know if I was the only one who thought this, was a turning point in show business, was when they brought back the Hollywood Squares a few years ago, and Whoopi Goldberg and Alec Baldwin were on it, and they got paid millions of dollars to be on it, and that used to
they
be
did millions?
For more.
Yeah, let Frank off. He's very passionate about the Hollywood Squares and the corruption
That used to be a vehicle for Rosemarie and Marty Allen and like mid, you know, people, so that they could have a TV thing and then they could get live gigs off of it.
Yes.
So it's like, well, in show business, the middle class has also been squeezed out.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Like, for example, Eddie Pepitone, big star, Bob's Burgers.
He's would make Eddie the center square in a second.
Well, I'm saying, what's he doing on this podcast? He's taking work away from other deserving, low-rung comics. Here's the question about the Yankees. They're a notoriously conservative organization. They buy pennants, right?
They used to buy pennants, and now all the teams kind of...
Tickets are overpriced.
Yeah.
Pinstripes, synonymous with Wall Street. How would you respond to people who say that inside of Eddie Pepitone, there's a one percenter screaming to get out, and where do you keep this one percenter?
Well, it is true.
How did you like the Yankees?
Well, the answer is when I was a kid, you know, if anybody's a sports fan out there, this is a real sincere answer, you know, you become a real proponent of your team when you're a kid, and you're like, oh my God, I loved Mickey Mantle growing up, and it was just like Mickey Mantle. There was something about Mickey Mantle. I became a Mickey Mantle fan, and I'll never forget in Staten Island throwing up a rock and hitting it with a wiffle ball bat and imagining I was Mickey Mantle, you know, and then inside
desperate
my
need of a new liver.
You know, yeah, I never knew I was such an innocent kid, you know. I mean, there was so much drinking going on inside my house. I never knew there was that much drinking going on outside my house.
Do you know why he was called Whitey Ford? No, seriously.
Was he pasty from drinking?
Do you know why he was called Whitey Ford?
Cocaine use?
Yeah.
He drank so much. He was cloudy all the time, and they called him Whitey because
is that true?
Yes, he could. His memory was completely shot, and
holy shit, I didn't know that.
That was why they nicknamed that other guy Wet Brain Maris.
Well, actually, they should have called Roger Maris Whitey because they were so upset. Weren't they upset with Roger Maris?
He broke Ruth's record, yeah. And they were upset about that. All the people who would vote for Trump, they were like, how dare you?
Because wasn't Babe Ruth
Babe Ruth's record.
Wasn't Babe Ruth secretly an African-American? Seriously, wasn't that the rumor?
No, I never heard that before.
The rumor was that he and Mae West were really African-Americans.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
I never heard. Is that because...
I go by the color of the skin. They look white as hell to me. I mean, I'm a stickler for that.
Okay.
I'm a traditionalist.
You purport to be a Rangers fan.
I am. I'm going to the Rangers tomorrow. Caroline's got me tickets to the Rangers Penguins.
What's it like to be a star? What are the perks? Is that one of them?
You know, that really, that you know, and talking about the one percenter that lives inside me, like when a television show flies me first class, my first thought is, yeah, fuck everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I know, right?
And like, I love watching the people who are going to coach come down the row, and I want them to see me. Like, I just look up at them like, you see this? That's because I'm better than you. Do you understand that?
That's why I hate being the guy in coach walking through. I love it when they put first class on the other side of the door so you don't have to walk through.
Yeah, it's kind of a walk of shame, right?
It's a total walk of shame.
You see, I've actually seen fucking friends of mine. Like, hi, Mark, Maron. He's like, hey. Yeah. Doesn't even give me shit. Like, hey, how you doing? Yeah.
I taught my kids.
Hey, Patton. You know, all that shit.
When we were going through the first class cabin into coach, I taught my kids, this is when you fart.
That's a great.
I can't
piece of
fart on
right
command
there.
As much as
well. My
I've
my
tried.
Son can, and and my daughter. Why didn't you ask me to fart? Why don't? Anyway, that's a whole other issue. A couple of $1,000 in therapy. Why my son? But we don't want to talk about that. But yes, my son would stink up the first class cabin.
Good for him.
And coach, unfortunately.
Good for him.
So you purport to be a Rangers fan?
Yeah, I am. I'm hockey's my favorite sport. And I think it's because I really get out my aggression with, like, you were talking about my anger before. And there's something very aggressive. Like, baseball is such a, like, and there's a fly ball to right field. And Johnson is drifting under it. It's, you know, it's like being in a bookstore when you're at a baseball game. But hockey is like, oh, look, I hit him, you know, like that kind of thing. And I leave games feeling a little bit lighter. And purged of some.
You know that most of those fights. You know R.J. Freed, the comedy writer.
I've heard of him. Yeah,
he's a forward. He was a forward at Harvard.
Oh, was he a hockey player?
Forward. And he told me that most of the fights are two guys who have to prove that they have skin in the game. Like they're about to be cut from the team, so they go, "Hey, you want to?"
A bunch of the fights are like that.
Yeah,
yeah.
They really don't hurt.
But hockey's changed. They got rid of the goons.
So
I don't know if you know that, but the goon hockey doesn't exist anymore. What?
Well, that guy had that. There was a documentary about that guy, the enforcer who had all that brain damage and became a Republican. You saw that story.
You talking about McCain?
No, that was...
No, it's just that was a Conniffian. Who?
Oh, hang on. Frank, knock it off.
No, I know all the enforcers, but who was a
Republican?
There was one
guy who... No, there was one guy who just died of brain damage.
A lot of them have died of brain damage, the quote-unquote enforcers. Mm-hmm. Suicide,
but,
too.
But
same concussion syndrome.
But most of them... How can you tell
addiction?
If it's brain damage? Because most of them are Canadian.
That's a low
hey, come
blow.
Come on, these are because nice people here.
I just came from Vancouver, and those people were so fucking nice.
I love the Canadians.
Yeah, they're great.
We have a lot of listeners.
They're
in
so
Canada,
much,
and I. But I'm not. That's
more peaceful than us.
They're good people.
Yeah.
Is it true that you lost your virginity to Ed Jockman in the back of a Zamboni machine? Who is Ed Jockman?
He's the goaltender. Now, you know, now when I was growing up, Ed Jockman's the goalie for the Rangers. And me and my dad had season tickets for a couple of years. And you know what? The crowd would chant. I'm kidding. And I was a kid around 13, 14. Not to brag, I had that kind of lifestyle. And the crowd would chant, Eddie, Eddie. And that was my name. And I would just be like, this is fucking great. I think I am going to become an entertainer and have my name chanted. Now, my name has never been chanted at a club yet, but I'm hoping. No, it has been a couple
and
of
why
times,
was Ed Jockman famous? He was
he was great. That's why. He was a really good goalie.
He was a goalie, and what did he refuse to wear?
I think it was thongs.
Yes.
No, I don't know. I don't know.
Wear the mask. He was the last guy to wear a mask.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
Well, that's insane.
Wait, he didn't wear a mask?
He did not wear a mask.
Wow.
That's why he was famous.
Right. He had a face for radio.
Yes. And who was the goalie for the Bruins who had like a scar on his mask for every time the mask hit him in the face?
Oh, Jerry Cheevers?
That is correct. Mm. And is it... Now, you work for Madison Square Garden. You got a job in the early 80s?
Yes. How did you know that?
Because I read that you took all your sanding skills and you got a job.
I was doing horrible jobs. That was an awful job.
This is a question that, I want a serious answer to this. Is it true that you once drove the Zamboni machine from New York to San Francisco in support of Ronald and Nancy Reagan's stance on AIDS? Is that true? Why? First of all, Hillary Clinton had a backtrack this week.
Yes.
Her support of Nancy Reagan.
Look, I was afraid of AIDS.
Yeah.
Like everybody else. And I also, I think, was still reacting to Lou Gehrig's disease. I didn't know how to treat any of these diseases, and I wanted to know what Yankee AIDS was named after, because I didn't know, you know.
Very quickly, Frank Conniff, in the Gay Hockey League, what were the Rangers called?
In the Gay Hockey League?
Very quickly.
What were
the Rangers called?
The Rump Rangers?
That is correct.
Oh, very good. Very good.
That was wasn't that worth it?
That is the correct answer. We should give points. Yeah. Is it true that your sister, your older sister, was such a big fan of Ed Gilbert from the Rangers?
Rod Gilbert. Yeah.
Yeah. Ed Gilbert's was his brother who played for the Bruins.
Yeah, yeah.
That your sister was such a big fan of Rod Gilbert that she had all her teeth removed so they could look. Is that true? These are just questions that.
Well, you know, fellatio wasn't as widespread as it was back then, and she was a pioneer in that field. This is going to come back to haunt me, that line. See, you forced me into these things.
Let's talk about Monsanto.
It's funny how our hockey conversation in the middle broke out into a lull.
I went to a hockey game, and I went to a fight, and a hockey game broke out. That's the original joke.
Right.
I never played hockey, but I often have pulled men's shirts off over their heads.
And to do what?
I don't want to go into. Okay. Let's talk about Monsanto.
Oh, wow, I love that company. I was saying earlier that there's an attention to detail at Monsanto that is beautiful and not only done in some of the nicer restaurants here on the Lower East Side.
Oh, the restaurant Monsanto.
No. What are we talking about? Yeah, the restaurant Monsanto is terrific. That's farm to table to prison. To grave. Farm to table to prison to grave. It's the new movement, you know? Yeah, absolutely.
I bring this up because an old girlfriend of yours gave an interview in the National Enquirer claiming that you gave her, shall we say, Rosebud, the nickname Monsanto. Is that true? That
I gave what? I wish I can't even keep up with these.
Her clitoris. Yeah. You nicknamed it her Monsanto. What is that about? Why would you do that? And why would she come?
Have you never had any experience with a genetically modified clitoris?
Genetically,
have you not?
Genetically engineered genitalia.
Genetically engineered genitalia.
Which you have.
Well, absolutely. I was part of an experiment at MIT. And it was another way I supplemented my income as a floor sander was to engage, let's say, with genetically modified genitalia.
Do you want to give your claim to fame?
Oh, my grandfather?
Uh-huh.
Oh, what happened?
Come talk into the microphone.
Here.
I don't mean to lord this over you, but Dan Abraham is here.
Yeah.
And he's going to... This is closeness to greatness.
This is as close as...
Talk to the microphone.
This is my credit.
The microphone.
Into the microphone. My grandfather was an endocrinologist, and he discovered with his partner a testicular deformity that now bears my last name, and it is the most... talk about SEO. you Google my full name.
Abraham?
Soval. This is why I have to do Abraham. Because the medical listings for this testicular deformity take up a good portion of the first, you know.
So you share a surname with a testicular
form. Half of it. It's Soval-Soffer syndrome is what it's called. Named
could
after
you take a look at something before I leave today? I've got the strangest. Well, I don't.
That's impressive.
Yeah, for my grandfather, it's very impressive for me. It's very humiliating, and I appreciate you bringing me on for the first time on your podcast.
Well, I just
to discuss this with your legions of listeners.
We have testicular deformity royalty in our midst. How could I not?
No, I get a little check every month. You know,
is it a residual?
Yeah, it is. Well, it's a residual genital residual. It's a small residual. For small deformed testicles, yeah.
Wow.
I don't mean to try to top you, but my grandfather also.
By the way, Merv Griffin picked me up once in a bar saying, I don't mean to top you.
Okay, that was worth the interruption.
Thank you for slamming him on that.
No, but it's my.
Alex is so happy right now.
Yeah. Yeah, that for me too, and I haven't been around them for years.
Go ahead.
The moment has passed.
No, go ahead.
No, sorry, the moment
no,
is passed.
You don't mean to touch. See, that's what he does.
No. Hang on for 1 second. We were talking about testicular deformities being named.
Forget it.
Why don't you?
No, because what Conniff was going to do wasn't that good to begin with, right. And then you delay it. And now it's really going to be shitty.
I just know what the shame is going to feel like when it comes out.
But don't you want to be like me?
No.
That is impressive, Dan. That's really impressive. Testicular deformity lineage in your family is a terrific, terrific thing to be known for.
I don't think deformity. Are you okay with that?
Too late now.
Like no, I mean you shouldn't feel bad because my father is only known for screaming in the middle of the street covered in blood. So, I mean, I would go with your lineage. You know, that's what he's known for in Staten Island. Very popular.
What happened?
No, just that's what he would do. You know, he would say nothing else is working. Let me try this. Just cover himself in blood and scream in the street. And he became known for it, and then. You know, it was a nice little living.
Your father took you to Ranger games?
Yeah, he did. I shouldn't.
Is he coming to your show at Caroline's?
No, he doesn't know I'm in New York.
Really?
Yeah. I don't
know. One way to
him.
Keep it a secret was to come on the show.
Yeah. Yeah. When is the podcast coming out?
What are you talking about, podcast?
What is this?
Just we invited you over to talk.
That would be funny if this was not being recorded. Like, we find out you're completely insane. You're like, don't fucking record any of these.
Your father, didn't he? How are we doing on time?
I have about 5 minutes before I have to headline.
Caroline.
It makes me so nervous to do that.
Who are you following?
Who am I following?
Yeah.
Comedically?
Yeah. No, like at Caroline's.
Oh!
Who's going on before you?
Tonight, Jimmy LaChase.
He's
featuring for me.
Right, okay.
Yeah, nice young kid.
Now, you travel the road. Do you ever have opening acts who get under your skin?
Nah, they never bother me.
Never?
They're usually really, they're always really nice. I haven't really met an asshole like who opens for me because, you know, they want to climb the ladder. You know, there isn't a guy who, like, you know, you come into a club and he goes, hey, so are you the headliner?
Mm-hmm.
You piece of shit, huh? I'm opening for you, you fucking ugly fuck.
Who are the young...
Watch my set and learn. That's why I'm featuring.
Here's another question. As we all know, former Secretary of Labor Robert Reich was performing a medley of Woody Guthrie songs during a taping of Carpool Karaoke on the Late Late Show.
Carpool Karaoke. That's what James Corden
does,
huh?
Very delightful.
Poor fuck.
Very
Corden, delightful.
You were caught on tape going 90 miles per hour in the opposite direction.
While carpool karaoke was going on.
With former Secretary of Labor Robert Reich doing a medley of Woody Guthrie songs. And you were going in the opposite. This all was on CBS. You were mm-hmm. attempting to create a head-on collision in the opposite direction.
Right.
At the very last minute,
right.
you stopped. This is all on tape. I've seen
right.
it.
I have friends at CBS.
You got out of the car,
right.
looked up, saw a billboard for Neighbors 2. You held a gun to your head, dropped your pants, and screamed into James Corden's camera on the dash cam, "I'm masturbating to the image of Zac Efron, not Seth Rogen, who is prominently featured on this billboard, standing next to his comely co-star, Rose Byrne, who was delightful in Bridesmaids, which, by the way, I've seen 5 times, and I'm a huge, huge fan of Judd Apatow as a producer, not a director. I thought the first season of Girls was some of the best producing work Judd Apatow has ever done.
Did he do Girls?
But I am specifically masturbating to Zac Efron. My question, Eddie, is why don't you like Woody Guthrie?
Amazing how the newspapers get it to the word like that.
Well, it was caught on tape.
Oh, it was caught on tape.
You're a big James Corden fan, but you don't like Woody Guthrie.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I wish that Woody Guthrie could have met James Corden, because that is a tragedy.
Woody Guthrie wrote a song about Donald Trump's father. That's
true.
Did he?
Tell us about that.
Did he?
Did he slam him? He lived in one of his buildings in Queens.
True?
Yes, mm-hmm. true. This just came out a few years ago.
Was he a slumlord?
He was a slumlord, and he wrote about what a racist he was.
Holy shit. I'm not making
it up.
Now, what are the odds that Woody Guthrie would be a big Lou Gehrig's fan?
And
what are the odds that Woody Guthrie would die from?
He didn't die from Lou Gehrig's disease, though, did he?
No.
He died from Pete Seeger's disease.
No, Pete Seeger's disease! That's good. Especially since Seeger outlived him.
No, but his son, Arlo Guthrie, has the same disease, and he's still alive. He has Parkinson's, I think.
It's not Parkinson's.
Arlo Guthrie has that?
I believe so.
Well, you can get anything you want, right. but a cure for Parkinson's. That was a low blow, and I'm sorry about that.
Excuse me for 1 second. The gay title for Alice's Restaurant.
For Alice's Restaurant? I don't know. I just know that it's one of Chris Christie's favorite films.
I miss your Chris Christie joke. What a piece of shit. Really shows you, the scum Trump is, to have Chris Christie. By the way, they got rid of that, huh? What was the internet went nuts about Christie standing behind Trump.
What was he doing
that became such a thing?
And then Trump was pissed because all the Trump steaks were gone.
Hey, I had a fucking cupcake here. Red Velvet, my favorite. Where the fuck is it?
Frank has written about 500 Chris Christie is fat jokes.
I love it. Has he lost some weight, though, Christie?
He's lost.
He's had some surgery.
I'm sure he's had the surgery. 2 or 3 tons, but it doesn't show up.
He had his dignity removed in a mm-hmm. lap band surgery.
When he got weighed a few years ago, the doctor just said, "You weigh as much as Battery Park." Sorry about that, everybody. I didn't want to go out on that, but I got to.
You know why it's called Battery Park?
Why?
Just a bunch of dildos.
That was worse than mine.
How are we doing on time?
We gotta go.
Last question, and then
last question. Okay.
Dr. Ben Carson was your twins. You were Siamese twins with your sister.
I don't like to talk about it.
Tell me about your twin sister. An address claims that Ben Carson separated you from your twin sister, and that you and she were attached at the genitalia. Do you still keep in touch with your twin sister, and is she still a segment producer on the Steve Harvey Show?
Can I let Frank answer that one?
Yes, I'd be very happy to to answer that.
Well, anything involved with Steve Harvey is good for our family.
She does work on the Steve Harvey Show, and she read my packet and said, yeah, I don't really think you're right for this.
And yeah. Is Logo the gay network?
It is when I watch it.
Is Logo the gay network?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what's gay. A river runs through it. I'm kidding. I don't even know why I said that.
So if you
I just thought that was funny.
If you want to submit a writing sample to Logo, Frank, what do you have to give them instead of a package?
A package you have to give them.
Yeah, I guess. A package? I don't know.
They love packages.
A fudge packet.
Oh, a fudge packet. Okay, wow.
Why are you doing this with the gay thing? What the fuck?
I like to quiz Frank to make sure. Right. This is as you get older. You haven't reached my age yet.
Okay.
That you have to test each other to make sure that
you
the
still
muscle
have it.
Is still
you still
working.
Have it. Yeah. You still have it. Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Let me just say from the bottom.
Yeah.
Let me just say, honestly, this did not turn out.
You know, when you said, this is honest, when you said, you've got questions from listeners, I was like, this is fucking great. Some people know who I am out there. They actually have questions for me. And then I get this
Those
shit.
Those were real questions.
Your fucking jokes that I, you know what I mean? It was, but I did enjoy myself.
I'm glad you did because I got to be honest with you. I was hoping the mistake we made is this is right before your show at Caroline, so you want some reserve energy.
I do.
But this I was one of your first fans and you were my muse.
You disappointed in me?
I'm really just not,
Well, I don't blame you.
I love you so much. You know that. You are, I mean, and Frank, talk about how great Eddie is. Seriously.
That is so funny the way, like, you had nothing more to say. God, I don't know what to say about Eddie. Frank, help me out. How great is he? Eddie, I have no fucking idea.
I'll say this. Eddie is probably the greatest talent in the business who will talk to me.
Thank Eddie Pepitone, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, Davey.